Welcome to the video series, The Operational Amplifier, From Abstraction to Reality. This first video in the series is Operational Amplifier History. I think that understanding how the operational amplifier was invented and how it evolved helps to understand their function and usage. Prior to the operational amplifier, the invention of a negative feedback amplifier was a paramount concept necessary for the development of the op-amp. Harold S. Black was a 29-year-old engineer at Western Electric Telephone Company, which eventually became Bell Telephone. He is famous for the invention of negative feedback. Long runs of telephone wires across the United States resulted in significant signal loss due to the resistance of the wire. Many repeater amplifiers had to be used in cascade to make up for the losses, typically every 25 miles. This left the industry plagued by distortion of cascaded repeaters. Vacuum tubes were all they had for amplifiers, and they are, of course, very nonlinear. Each successive cascaded stage added more nonlinearities. Mr. Black's goal was to make amplifiers with the best linearity. He lived in Massachusetts and took the Lackawanna Ferry across the Hudson River to work at Bell Labs in New York City every day. An idea came to him as a flash on the ferry ride to work August 6, 1927. He suddenly realized that if he fed the amplifier output back to the input in reverse phase and kept the device from oscillating, that he could have exactly what he wanted, a means of canceling out the distortion in the output. He opened his morning newspaper on a page in the New York Times that was nearly blank where the ink did not press well. He proceeded to sketch a canonical diagram of the negative feedback amplifier plus the equations for the amplification with feedback. The date is clear on the newspaper, and it was witnessed and understood by Bell Labs employee that very day. Within a few years, Harry Nyquist of Sweden would publish his generalized rule for avoiding instability in a feedback amplifier, and Hendrik Bode from Madison, Wisconsin would spearhead the development of systematic techniques of design where one could get the most out of a specified situation and still satisfy Nyquist's criterion. Through their work, as well as the efforts of many others, the feedback amplifier was launched on the road that within 25 years would lead to a report that said the negative feedback principle is now applied almost universally to amplifiers used for any purpose. Distortion was just one problem solved by negative feedback. A vacuum tube amplifier's gain would vary with its transconductance, which is the change in plate current divided by the corresponding change in the grid to cathode voltage. This was never very consistent across devices and was also affected by aging. This meant you never knew precisely what the gain of the amplifier would be. The same held true for the transistor amplifier. The beta of a transistor, which is the ratio of the collector current to the base current, varies between devices and ages with time. We will later look at the profound effects of negative feedback on gain stabilization, but let's first look at the math for negative feedback. Here's a control theory model of an amplifier with negative feedback. A sub V is the open loop gain of the amplifier, the gain without feedback. Ideally, this gain would be infinite. We want to determine the closed loop gain of the negative feedback system, which is the ratio of the output voltage, V sub O, to the input voltage, V sub I. It's the gain with the negative feedback loop closed. The block labeled beta is the feedback factor. This is often a set of resistors performing voltage division that in effect programs the gain of the amplifier. Beta times V sub O is the portion of the output fed back to the input. A sub V times beta is the gain around the feedback loop. let's write the loop equation for the output voltage. It's A sub V times the input voltage minus the product of beta times the output voltage per the diagram. This equation is rearranged to show the ratio of the output voltage to the input voltage, which is the closed loop gain. If we make the assumption that the open loop gain is near infinity, the term 1 over A sub V becomes 0, and the closed loop gain is simply 1 over beta. Let's make a plot of the amplifier gain versus log frequency. Here's the large open loop gain at 120 dB. It falls off at a 20 dB per decade slope due to the dominant pole in the amplifier. When the negative feedback is applied, the closed loop gain is lower, in this case 40 dB, and well controlled. The point where it meets the open loop gain slope is referred to as the closed loop frequency. The part of the gain thrown away is the open loop gain, A sub V, multiplied by beta. The open loop gain is 1,000,000 multiplied by the beta of 0.01. This equals 10 e to the fourth. 20 log of 10 e to the fourth is 80 dB of gain thrown away. It took 9 years for the patent to be issued for the negative feedback amplifier. The concept was so contrary to beliefs, it wasn't accepted. Throwing away gain was counterintuitive, and people thought it was crazy. The patent was finally issued, and this concept of throwing away gain revolutionized our electronics world forever. I mentioned how another important aspect of negative feedback is the ability to accurately control the gain of the amplifier. Let's talk about gain stabilization. When I say gain stabilization, I don't mean the amplifier is free from oscillation. I mean that the voltage gain is well controlled and accurate. Let's take a case where the open loop gain is 50,000 and the feedback factor beta is 0.01. which is a voltage gain of 100. Using the closed loop equation we developed earlier, utilizing open loop gain, yields an actual gain of 99.8, very close to the 100. Now let's see what happens if, for some reason, the open loop gain degrades to 5,000. This results in a gain of 98.04, which is only 0.15 dB of gain reduction. That's hardly noticeable. Modern-day op-amps have open-loop gains in the range of 10 to the 5th or 10 to the 7th. Let's assume an open-loop gain of 10 to the 6th. The difference between the actual gain versus the calculated gain using the ideal infinite gain abstraction is completely negligible, having a 0.0087 dB error. With modern-day op-amps having such high open-loop gain, it would not be worth considering the actual open loop gain versus the infinite abstract assumption. Also, it's important to note that the resistors in the feedback network for programming gain will generally only have a tolerance accuracy of 1%. Resistor tolerance will result in a bigger gain variation than the error from the infinite abstract assumption. Spawned from the concept of negative feedback, the first operational amplifier entered the commercial market in 1952. George Philbrick developed the K2W vacuum tube operational amplifier. Here are some excerpts from the original brochure. This first example is the application of a wide range gain amplifier using a potentiometer to set the gain. Notice the input required a bias battery B. A voltage reproducer is what we now call a unity gain buffer, where all the output is fed back to the input. This makes for a high input impedance and a low output impedance, and of course, low distortion. The objective of the operational amplifier was to accomplish analog computing, so mathematical solutions were established. See the adder and subtractor here, the same configuration we see in modern-day op-amp applications, except, of course, for the battery. It was also an objective, as an analog computer, to simulate dynamical systems, like a differentiator function and an integrator function, in this case, a subtracting integrator. The absolute value circuit was also introduced, producing the basic function of a full-wave rectifier. Here is the schematic diagram of the Philbrick K2W. Note the resistor values are in megaohms, unless otherwise noted. That was common in those days, since most 2-amp resistors were high resistance. Here's the differential amplifier section, like the modern-day transistor equivalent. It's followed by a common cathode gain stage, again like the modern-day transistor equivalent. The output is a cathode follower, which provides a low output impedance. Let's take a look at the K2W specifications and juxtapose them with the modern-day op-amp specifications. The K2W open-loop gain was 15,000. Today's op-amps have gains as high as 10 million. Of course, the power dissipation was high for tubes, especially considering the heater filament, which added up to 6.5 watts. A typical op-amp today draws about 85 microamps, not counting the load current. The K2W had two 12AX7 tubes, which now are monolithic bipolar FET and CMOS transistors. The size is a big change from an 8-pin tube plug to surface mount technology. Having a control grid input, the K2W did have a large input impedance of greater than 100 megaohms. I found some op-amps that have as much as 6 teraohms input impedance today. While the open-loop impedance of the K2W was about 1K, just the nature of negative feedback resulted in an output impedance of less than 1 ohm. Typical op-amp open-loop impedance today is 20 ohms. Drift rate in an op-amp is the change in input offset voltage with temperature and over time. The K2W had 5 millivolts drift per day. A typical op-amp today will only have about 1 microvolt per degree C and twice the max offset spec over 10 years. Again, the size is a major change going from tubes to surface mount at almost a tenth of an inch square. The K2W requires plus or minus 300 volts for power, but only had an output range of plus or minus 50 volts. Modern op-amps can run rail to rail on inputs and outputs. Tube control grids had very low input current, but I've seen some devices as low as 5 picoamps of input current. The tube's output current was only plus or minus 1 milliamp into a 50K load. A typical op-amp can drive 60 milliamperes. What's funny is the K2W required an external bias supply of about 1.5 volts to bring it into balance. Typical input offset voltage today is on the order of 100 microvolts. The bandwidth of the K2W was 100 kHz. Notice it was specified as KC, kilocycles, back before the credit was given to Heinrich Hertz. It was adopted by the General Conference on Weights and Measures in 1960. Op-amps today can operate as high as 1.5 GHz. In 1963, a 26-year-old engineer named Robert Wadlar designed the first monolithic op-amp integrated circuit, the Micro A702, at Fairchild Semiconductor. It sold for $300. Wadlar followed up with an improved design, the Micro A709, cutting the cost to $70 and making the chip a huge commercial success. The story goes that the freewheeling Wadlar then asked for a raise. When he didn't get it, he quit. National Semiconductor, now part of Texas Instruments, was very happy to scoop up a guy who was helping establish the discipline of analog IC design. In 1967, Weidlar created an even better op-amp for National, the LM-101, a version which is still in production. After National Semiconductor decided to save money on lawn mowing, Weidlar bought a sheep and delivered it in his Mercedes-Benz convertible to the grounds of National Semiconductor to eat the grass. Local newspapers had a field day with that. While Weidlar managers fretted about the sudden Weidlar-powered competition, meanwhile, over at Fairchild's R&D lab, a recent hire, Dave Fulligar, scrutinized the LM-101. He realized that the chip, however brilliant, had a couple drawbacks. The biggest was that the IC's input stage, the so-called front end, was overly sensitive to noise in some chips because of semiconductor quality variations. Fulligar embarked on his own design. The solution to the front end problem turned out to be profoundly simple. He said, "It just came to me, I don't know, traveling to Tahoe, and consisted of a couple extra transistors." That additional circuitry made the amplification smoother and consistent from chip to chip. Fulligar took his design to the head of research and development at Fairchild, a guy named Gordon Moore, who sent it to the company's commercial division. The new chip, the Micro-A741, would become the new standard for op-amps. That IC and variants created by Fairchild's competitors have sold in the hundreds of millions. Fast forward, the number of op-amps available nowadays is daunting. Here is Mauser's product selector. There are 8,890 general-purpose op-amps available, and 2,239 in the high-speed category. Granted, there are general op-amp part numbers that are offered by several companies, so lots of duplicates exist, but that's still a lot of op-amps. Manufacturers include Analog Devices, Maxim, Microchip, ON Semiconductor, ST Microelectronics, National or Texas Instruments, and more. In future videos, we'll look at various aspects of the specifications and what to look for in selecting an operational amplifier.